Good afternoon, everyone. It is 2:00 on Tuesday afternoon, the 30th of June. This is the fourth session, an optional one, of the Budget Committee for the City of Topeka, for the City Council. That is, the Budget Committee is actually a committee of the whole of the Council. The purpose for the meeting today was that we had some members of the Council that really wanted to have a walkthrough of the budget book by department. And we really appreciate the staff's willingness to step forward and do that. We have here right now Councilwoman Lane Schwartz from District 7 and myself from District 1. We are expecting at least one other council person, but as it is 2:00 and time to roll, we will simply get started. Are there any general comments or announcements that we need to make before we start? Staff Budget Director Nikki Lee is here, as well as Doug. What is your long title again?
Director of Administrative and Financial Services and sometimes Utilities.
Director of Administrative and Financial Services Doug Gerber will be our key staff, but it's my understanding that I haven't counted exactly, but that we've got the department heads from all of the departments here to at least answer questions, if not give some short presentations for us. Anything? Let's just roll. I'll hand the baton off to, we will officially call this meeting to order, and I'll hand the baton off to Nikki Lee, the budget manager. Thank you so much.
Sure. What we've done is we've gone ahead and lined up an order that we think makes sense, not necessarily the book order, but we'll definitely refer you to what page whenever those directors come up. We've kind of lumped together. For example, we'll start with administrative and internal services. We'll do public safety at once. So kind of lump them in like areas.
But we'll get them all before we get done?
That's the goal.
Okay.
The idea is that we've recommended that department directors give a brief introduction and then leave as much time for questions as needed. So some have handouts, some don't. We're just going to kind of be flexible and kind of let it flow here. And I think we'll start here with Doug Gerber, who's going to give the introduction for the administrative and internal service departments.
Let me go ahead and throw in one sort of point of order. This is scheduled as a 3-hour meeting. I do not know if we'll need the whole 3 hours. We will start now. We will plan to take a break, as we have with the other meetings, at an hour and a half point, so at 3:30. So we can more or less kind of gauge how things are going and make sure we get that break in. Thank you. Go ahead, Doug.
Deputy Mayor, I'll segue with points that both you and Nikki Lee made, and that is this is a little bit of a new process for several of us, especially the two people sitting right here, and so we had some internal discussions about how we wanted to handle this. Depending on how you count it, we have anywhere from 11 to 13 departments. So if each department takes even 10 minutes, that constitutes a significant chunk of time. And so what we've asked departments to do is to make a 5-minute presentation and then leave 5 minutes for question and answer, and then we can wrap back around at the end for any outstanding questions. We're really gonna try to stay on that schedule. We wanna get you all the information you need, but in the interest of time and not having another lengthy meeting, we really want to try to stay with that 10 minutes.
So you are wanting, if people have more questions, then we'll fit into that 5-minute window for them to hold it all the way to the end?
Obviously, we don't want to interrupt good discussion, and so there, as Nikki said, we'll have to have some free flow to this.
Okay.
But in general, we want to try to limit those, again, just so we can roll through all of the departments that we need to.
Okay.
Make sense?
Work.
Obviously, some departments won't take 5 minutes, some may take longer than that, and so, again, the word of the day is be flexible. That's what we're trying to
do. Well, we'll look to you to flow or cut off then and try and make notes if people have questions.
Sounds good. So with that in mind, with your permission, I'll go ahead and start off with some of the departments under my lengthy title, Administrative and Financial Service, and we'll what we've kind of talked with everyone about doing is giving some highlights of their budget, including the overall budget amount, the number of FTEs in the budget, and then a little more specifically what that budget amount gets the city for that dollar amount. So some of the services that each department provides. that may naturally lead to questions, and if it does, then we'll, of course, jump into those. So we'll start off with, I think, what is a fairly easy and recognizable department under administrative and financial services, and that is the finance department itself. Of course, we're the department that you hear about all the time that's winning a lot of national awards. That's us. We have...
Just had to slip that in, huh?
I did, absolutely. We have an overall budget of $2.4 million. $1.9 million of that is actually for financial services, and then $500,000 of that goes towards procurement, purchasing, as many folks know it.
Should we be at a certain tab right now, just to follow you?
Page 24.
Thank you.
Page 24, I have it right in front of me. So this department has 25 FTEs. That's an increase of one full-time employee from 2015. That employee, as we've talked about in the first budget meeting, is our internal auditor position that was previously a contract employee, and that will now become, and that person worked half-time for us and half-time for another entity. Beginning in 2016, that person will work full-time for the City of Topeka. And although its position and funding will be housed in administration and finance, the position will answer to the city manager. One of the things that people often don't realize that the finance department does, it's in a number of places depending on the city you're in. In Topeka, it happens to be in finance, and that is we do payroll. That's one of the big functions of the finance department. For example, in 2014, we processed 28,500 ACH payrolls, so payroll checks essentially, 6,100 accounts payable checks, 250 bids came from procurement and purchasing, two GFOA awards, one bond rating upgrade. So those are the sorts of things you get for the $2.4 million that comes from the finance budget. As you know, we've also tried to increase our reporting responsiveness to the council, and we now do both monthly and quarterly reports to the council that give a broad overview of our financial situation.
Questions? Councilwoman Schwartz.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I really appreciate the staff, city staff, being here to go into more detail in depth in this. I came with several questions that I wanted to, you know, figure out if I needed to make an amendment at the budget meetings and figure out where that could be done. And I know we've heard this question over and over about a grants writer in administrative and finance, and I'm not sure if that would go into the city manager's office or what. I have talked with Kelly, who is, I understand, going to be helping with, you know, checking with department heads and seeing if there's a grant that they need help with. That's not what I would like to see. I would like to see a full-time position dedicated to going after grants for the city. And I, being a former grants writer and working with a lot of grants, I went after one for $500,000 and we got it. So I really want to know where this grants writer full-time could go, whether it would be in administrative and finance, and where we could possibly, I know you've got quite a few positions in here, not that I think any of those should be done away with, but I really feel like as we deal with this budget that we need to figure out where we can find a full-time grants writer and not contact the department heads and ask, you know, well, are you going after any grants, going to help you with grants? That's not the issue here. The issue is a grant writer is also a grant searcher. I mean, they go to the .gov sites and they see what's there with all the federal agencies. They go to some of the nonprofits. So where would be the best place for a grants writer to reside? Would it be in administrative and financial? That's my question. Or in human resources, or where?
Councilwoman, I would answer the question this way. I think the grants writer is in the best place it could be right now. The way the city manager envisions it is that Kelly will be helping with departments, but also searching for grants herself and maybe just better coordinating that process. There's a lot of grants that happen right now. For example, in the water department, we just got a grant, probably 6 months ago, to help upgrade meters and to help pay for some AMR upgrades, advanced meter reading upgrades. And so those things are happening. I think Kelly's focus in helping coordinate the departments will make that better.
I don't think that having the city manager's assistant, what is her title?
Executive assistant.
I think what I'm trying to say is that we need someone dedicated strictly to going after grants and very specialized in that. I mean, that is a profession, and people know where to go to look for those grants rather than including it in a position that is staffing the city manager's office. So where would be the best place to transfer money from the budget that we now have for a full-time grant writer?
I think if that amendment were made on the 7th, which mm-hmm. is, I think, when we envision amendments being made, it could be housed in a number of different departments. Probably a more central department, such as the manager's office or administration and finance, would be the best place, though.
And as we have seen, that we have had jobs change in the last, 2 months or so, with the development of the neighborhood relations department and people were moved around and that type of thing. That's a possibility that we could just move someone into a full-time grant writing position or have a vacancy open up and then we take that vacancy and look for a grant writer.
Yeah, I'll also answer that one very generically, in that the city manager, of course, has the authority throughout the year to hire and fire as meets the needs of the organization.
Okay. So, Doug, are you recommending that if I make an amendment on the 7th, that I take that from another department, for example, from one department? I know that, you know, we have like arts, money for arts in there that we didn't have before. We have money for street cleaning that we didn't have before that's coming out of the motor fuels tax. But if I made an amendment to add a grant writer, a full-time position, and leave it to the city manager and the staff to figure out where that position goes, I'm kind of giving you a heads up.
So. Just for your information, we've met just to kind of plan how things would go on the 7th. If you are considering amendments, if anybody is, mm-hmm. What we'll do is take them one at a time, and there'll just be a one subject amendment. So if you want to add something, you'll just float the recommendation to add it.
Okay.
And then if you want to do a corresponding motion to delete something, that
okay.
would be a separate motion.
Okay.
You could let us know that's what you're going to do, but that's how those will go, so that they're simple and pretty clean.
Okay, thank you.
Do you have other questions, Councilwoman Schwartz,
no,
on this
thanks.
Department? I have one, and that would be regarding Lawson. When we put the Lawson software in, there was a vision that it would at that point ramp up quickly, and we know it's taken a little bit more time to get it in, but also that the efficiencies and economies that it would provide would in time, people thought, allow us to reduce a couple positions in finance. Could you respond to that? I'm not sure that it has. Any answers, okay. Just wondering where we are with Lawson and staffing.
So I wouldn't necessarily want to speak to how Lawson was envisioned, since that predated both of us sitting here.
Mm-hmm.
I know that for a number of systems that we've put in place, we have hopes that eventually, for example, with IntelliTime, as people move to more routine processing, more automated processing of time cards, that there is potential for realigning resources
mm-hmm.
instead of having them do sort of a manual processing of payroll, for example. We do envision a Lawson upgrade in the near term, and so we're hopeful that may allow us some more efficiencies as we move forward.
Thank you. And truly, that was just a question. I know that what happened was with the economic downturn, the positions that people thought they might be able to save for Lawson got cut out up front, which made it a little harder to get it up and going at the time. So hopefully those, if you're ready for an upgrade, then that sounds good. Other questions, Councilwoman? I was checking my phone, not to be rude, but to see if we'd heard from Councilman Cohen. He was expecting to come, so I haven't seen a message. So we'll keep going.
Okay, the next department that I would point you to is Human Resources. That is also under Administrative and Financial Services, and that's on page 40. And again, just by way of a very brief overview, the overall budget for Human Resources is $1.2 million. In 2016, there'll be 12 full-time employees. That's an add of one position, which we previously discussed. In 2015, it's 11, and that position is an HR specialist whose goal really will be to focus on citywide efficiencies, strategic planning, and policy reviews, those types of things that impact the entire organization, and to pull that together for everyone. HR, of course, does the normal type functions that you think of with the Human Resources Department: recruiting, retention, training, those sorts of things. They do a significant amount of that. Additionally, with the new focus on wellness and the wellness clinic coming, that'll be a big push, not only at the end of this year, but also moving into 2016 for their department and department staff. As you recall, last year we converted one position from a half-time position to a full-time position in anticipation of ramping up our wellness efforts, and we'll see that later in the year when the clinic opens and continuing into 2016.
Questions?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Doug, with the efficiencies of HR specialist, the state, I know, has a program that they award, and it's, I can't remember how much or what the monetary award is, but employees, state employees who come up with, you know, better ways to be more efficient, and it works, and there's some savings, they are awarded for that idea or that. It's not whistleblowing, but it's, you know, that we really don't need this process, and maybe it's costing the state more money to do it. And I know that that has worked well. Have we ever had any kind of program like that where we award employees who come up with suggestions to have efficiencies in city government?
I don't believe there's a formal program, although there is a group that meets currently, informally called the Innovations Team, to talk about ways to improve our procedures and processes. Now, there's no monetary reward associated with that. It's just the reward of doing a great job, I suppose. But there's no formal type of gain-sharing program, I guess what you would call it in the private sector.
Okay. Well, I would highly encourage somebody from administrative and finance to look into how the state does that, because it has there has been some savings. I don't know how long it's been in effect. It was there when I was there with the state, and that's been a few years ago. But I really think that I know you have innovators, but these are ideas that come from the bottom up, done, and people working in the trenches, that they see that this could be more, we could be more effective, more efficient if we had a system that we rewarded people for coming up with those ideas. So,
and I think we'll talk about this a bit more when we get to the executive budget, but certainly one of the focuses with some of the new staff has been external communication, but also internal communication. And that's not just Jim sending out a message to everyone, but that's the city manager receiving input from employees, and we've tried to strengthen that process a lot with the addition of the new staff. We've done things like when we have things we want to roll out to the public, we've had employee focus groups recently. For example, we did one on Lawrence Bay and Heartland Park, just to sort of vet the message and see how it's gonna react and get suggestions and feedback on that. So it's something we're trying in small stages.
Okay, good, thanks.
Good. Well, I have a positive comment on the HR specialist. Those who have followed some of the things that I've done, know that I've been working on seeing the city develop a what I call the construction management policy ever since the day the crane showed up in front of the U.S. Bank building in 2009. And the new HR specialist has been working that policy and has taken it from how it had developed over slowly over 5 years and has really vetted it with the staff. And they're now working on basically implementing it this summer in a soft implementation and working its provisions through the contracts and all the related policies and procedures. And so just as that, with that as an example, it seems to be working very well. We've needed a policy person and she seems to be doing well. So that's nice. Any other questions on HR? All right.
Thank you. Continuing along to information technology, I won't spend very much time on this since we've talked about the IT fund in detail. I believe at the second budget committee meeting, but overall they have a $3.6 million budget with 15 FTEs. Again, there's an add of an FTE in 2016, and it's not technically an add, it's just it was housed in the manager's office and now it's moving probably where it rightly belongs into information technology. It's a web developer position, which will be moving to IT in 2016, moving back to IT actually. IT focuses on three major areas really, the telecom program, computing program, and then the business systems program. They support the daily operations of over 1,000 PCs, 100 mobile devices, something I didn't even realize until just a little bit ago in talking with Mark, 100 servers, support for that. So they just provide the overall support for those as well as our citywide platforms such as Lawson or IntelliTime. They provide that daily and routine support.
Questions?
Thank you, Madam Chair. About 6 to 8 months ago, I think, I brought in someone that had worked in IT, and I think he was the head of IT for the city, and had an idea of the unifying the county and the city IT department. And I don't know that that has gone anywhere. I know there has been some discussions. I mean, we've unified the Parks and Rec, but my question deals then with City 4, which is used by the county, and how is the arrangement for City 4 to be used by the county?
That area is actually under the communications part of the city manager's office, but we can go ahead and jump right into that if you'd like.
Okay.
That question came up again during one of the budget committee meetings, and I believe that staff has made contact with the county and are starting those discussions. Right now, per a long-standing agreement, it's just a service that the city provides, but I believe they're making overtures about different ways to revise that without getting into details because it's very preliminary.
Okay, and I would also, I would encourage that we look into that. It's kind of like the officers with 501 and how Chief Brown helped to straighten that all out. So thank you.
Yes, those conversations, again, those have started and will continue, I think, until we get a good conclusion.
Okay.
Anything else? All right.
So maybe moving into the executive budget, which is on page 20. The executive budget is what we would commonly refer to as the city manager's office. They have a total budget of $1.3 million. In 2016, they will have 11 full-time employees. Four of those employees are located in the manager's office itself, then three are in the city clerk's office, and then three are in the city communications area, including the new director of media relations and some of the staff you see here doing the filming for us today. Some of the ideas that moving forward into 2016 that they'd like to focus on, we've touched on a couple of those. Obviously, the key focus for some of the new staff is improving internal and external communication. That's obviously much improved. There's a lot more messages going out from the city manager's office. Obviously, Allie Van Dyke's doing a really nice job with our media relations, and we're seeing some positive stuff in the press as opposed to getting creamed all the time, and so that's a nice change. And I know they want to do some things in terms of upgrading video quality and maybe making some improvements to our video feed moving forward in this year and next year. Again, a very brief overview of that office.
I'll ask a question here again. I know in talking to some constituents that the video feed, the audio especially, is not good with City 4. Is there going to be any improvements in that to make it so that it is not a problem for viewers at home to watch? I mean, is there any effort to look at that and see how we can improve that, since that's in this department?
Councilwoman, the short answer is yes. If you'd like additional details, I can have someone come up and walk through those with you, but the answer is yes.
Okay, so is that anywhere in the budget? Where could I find that we're spending money to do that?
This question did get asked earlier in our proceedings, and if I recall correctly, the issue is it's in the 2015 budget, because they are underway and they are expecting to complete those this year. Just to fast forward that, I might have asked the question myself, actually. So I think Megan Bottenberg from the city manager's office.
Good afternoon. So to answer that question, it is all part of the upgrade that has been completed recently within the past few weeks. And we are simply changing to a more, and let me get the correct terminology on this, but we are upgrading the system to be more fiber optic, I believe, and digital. That's the whole issue. And so as we were making that transition, the sound quality was not as good, and we had audio problems, but we have upgraded that, and it should not be a problem for the next council meeting.
Okay.
Cox in particular.
It was working, making all the communication parts communicate and work together.
We have, and I think you know, literally had constituents screaming about how frustrating it was to hear that. So with those items that are completed in the last couple of weeks, we should be starting at the very next meeting totally up to where the staff was feeling we needed to be?
Yes. July 7th meeting, everything should be in place and ready to go, and it should not be a problem.
Okay, we'll put all our constituents on, tell them all to watch this meeting, right? All right.
And Councilwoman, any more on that? If you look in your budget, you asked where you could find mm-hmm. that. If you look on page 23, there's a line item there, 55,800. Amount for 15 and 16 is $70,000. So that's where you could tie those improvements to in the budget.
Which line item?
It's line 55,800.
Okay.
It's the second from the bottom.
Okay.
Well, now 55,800 repeats the $70,000 in 2016, and we just discussed being done. So maybe you do need to explain that.
There continues to be upgrades.
I was just going to say that what that ties back to is the 2013 through 2017 CIP included $70,000 per year to go towards improvements in City 4. So that's where that dollar amount came from. Maybe what Macon can speak to is that even with the upgrade that we just completed, we still expect to have future needs going into 16.
We continue to expand our upgrade and the way we're able to provide services with City 4. So for instance, we want to continue and expand it over to Holiday Building, and so make it readily available, and then over here to the Law Enforcement Center, so that right now it takes about 6 hours for City 4 to come in, set up, and then 6 hours to tear it down. They essentially move their entire production over here. So in the future, what we want to do over the next year is upgrade this so that we don't have to take that long and set up and tear down, so that we don't have to move the entire production system over here, but it's simply set up, we can come in and set it up easily, and it makes things a lot easier and more efficient.
Okay.
Councilwoman.
Thank you. I know we had a JADO meeting that was held at Ag Hall or somewhere at the Expo Center, and it wasn't able to be aired. Is that, are we finding out that the only places we can do the filming is at the Law Enforcement Center and City Hall and possibly, and then the Holiday Building? But that also is an area that's not a very large area for, you know, the whole community to come to participate. But so is that, are we acknowledging that we have to have all of our official meetings where they can be televised?
We try to make that a priority as to where it can be televised. I'm not aware of the Ag Building.
Okay.
It was in Heritage Hall.
Heritage Hall.
I mean, it was filmed, but when it's off location, they can't do it live. It can be replayed, but just not live.
Okay.
So actually, though, what you're saying is that we would be setting up here and the Holiday Building with the same amenities that right now the municipal courtroom has, so that we have three instead of one that are
yes.
already wired and ready to go.
Yes.
Plug in, basically. Okay.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank
Good
you.
Question.
Mm-hmm.
Any, and so that will take the $70,000, you think?
Yes.
Other questions, Councilman? Okay. Thank you. I don't know if I need to say this across the room. My understanding was that Judge Miller had some time constraints. He is here. Mickey? Or if you can. Okay. I didn't know if.
I think now's probably a good time since we're kind of at the conclusion of administrative and financial services in the manager's office. So. We'll just have Judge come up.
All right.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Mayor. I am, when I was preparing my remarks, I prepared them for the new people, so I may do some adjusting here. I won't be very long. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before you. Topeka Municipal Court adjudicates traffic violations and misdemeanors committed within the city of Topeka. In 2014, that represented 30,244 cases. The staff is comprised of two judges, two administrators, Ms. Vaughn, who you met a couple of weeks ago, and her deputy, 11 clerks, clerical positions at least, four protective service officers, and four members of our probation department. In 2014, we collected $4,209,860 in fines, fees, and restitution. As far as the budget for 2016 is intended to be a status quo budget, if there are line items that raise questions, it's merely a matter of clarification. We're not intending to do anything differently, more or less, than we have been doing. The adjustments were made simply for actuals and for better estimates. Questions have come up. I've sat through the other hearings. I know questions have come up with regard to collections. We have two principal methods of collection of delinquent accounts. Let me back up, because we do our own in-house collecting prior to them becoming, or as they become delinquent. We have what we call time to pay dockets, where anyone that is more than 30 days overdue is summoned to court. Most of them don't show, but those that do show, we give them one last opportunity to work out a payment plan, because as I explained to them, the last thing we want to do is send their case to collection. It doesn't help us because we get no more money, and it doesn't help them because once it gets to collection, approximately 30% is added to what they owe, and that goes to the collection company, not to the court. So if we can get voluntary payment, that's what we do, and that's our last attempt to do that. That being said, when we do refer delinquent accounts, we have two places we refer them to. One's called State Set Off. I like it. We don't have to do anything. We just send it over there, and when the state owes that individual money for any reason, typically as a tax refund, it comes out of what the state owes them before they ever see it. We don't pay anything for that. There's a fee, but again, that's paid by the defendant to the state of Kansas for that service. The other avenue is we go conventional collection route. We have a collection company that we've been using now for the last 3 or so years. I found when I arrived at the court, we were not happy with the collection company that we had. It was a national firm, didn't have a local office, pretty much put up a minimal amount of effort in collection. They'd send a letter. People soon learned if they ignored the letter, they could ignore the letter, and that was the end of it. We have a very active collection company now that the demand letter failing, they will go to court. They will utilize all collection efforts, including garnishments, what have you, to collect those funds. I knew we had the right people when I found out early on that they had garnished one of our defendants who was in prison, and they took his prison account. So I said, okay, you can get blood out of a turnip. I appreciate that. Our set-off program, when I got there in 2012, we were collecting a minimal amount, just a little over $20,000. We, this year, thus far, have collected over $400,000. That's simply because we weren't sending but a small number of cases to set-off. I didn't know why, and I particularly don't know why we weren't more aggressive about that then, but everything goes to set-off now when it becomes delinquent. Our collection agency that we were using when I got there, we were getting about $10,000 a month from them. It was basically just the cream off the surface, but they'd send a letter, they'd take the easy money, and that was it. Our collections with the new firm have risen over time because we've sent more and more accounts to them. We took all those accounts back from the other company, and then we filtered them. We gave people, again, one chance to pay us before we sent them back into collection. And over time, we've filtered over 40,000 cases back into collection. We see an increase every month in our collections from the collection company. Now we're averaging about $50,000 a month from where we were 10. Just a word about the probation department, just so you know the magnitude of it. We currently have 285 people on probation. Those are essentially for alcohol violations, and the money is, some of that money, a big chunk of that money comes from what we call ADSAP funds, which is a state resource. I wanted to talk briefly, and I'm going to talk less briefly than I intended because you two have already heard all this. I was going to talk about the introduction of the alternative sentencing court. You saw the presentation. I brought some brochures for the new people. I won't go into anything in detail about that at this point since you've heard most of what I would have had to say, except to say that since I last appeared and spoke on the subject, we now have branched out. We have linked up with the Veterans Administration, and we're now receiving veterans as a special part of that program. It was actually initiated by the VA. There's a new outreach officer here who serves both the Leavenworth and the Topeka communities, but she approached us upon hearing about the alternative sentencing court and wanted to discuss whether that was an alternative for focusing on veterans who were before the court, and we agreed, and we now have already our first person in that aspect of the alternative sentencing court program. Looking forward to working with her to expand that. Hope that was enough. That's good. What I have.
Questions?
No. That's the kind of information and news we like to hear, that things are really working and actually improving, and we're garnering more revenue that should be paid to the city. Vic, I have a question about the fees and the fines that we are turning over to collection agencies. Does that include like the parking fines and any of those that we haven't from our other departments, or is this just all court fines?
We don't do parking.
Okay.
Parking's a separate agency.
Okay.
We do parking tickets if they are the more extended, like parking in the wrong place. We don't do overtime parking. That's generally what people, when they say parking, they're generally talking about your overtime parking. We don't do theirs. The parking division does those, and it's my understanding that they go to collection. I think they use the same company.
Well, I know we had an issue a year ago or so that somebody owed like $20,000. I mean, it was an outrageous amount. It was somebody that worked downtown, and their parking fines just kept building and building. So I guess my question is, do we have a collection? Do our parking fines go to collection? So they do.
You received an answer to the questions from a week ago that Nikki just sent out, and that's addressed in those questions that she just sent out with supplement on. She's got the actual amounts.
Okay. Yeah, I think we've got parking out and parking return in that. We were missing how much code compliance bills out. All we got was a number on return, but otherwise it was a fairly complete answer. It was out today. So okay. look for that.
We do. Like them, we do have people that owe outrageous amounts. We do what we can to collect from some people who like to roll up fines and fees but never pay them. You know, it's clientele we work with in many cases. They're what they call judgment proof. Mm-hmm. However, we don't give up. Last week, I was at jail. We do dockets each week at jail, and the gentleman that I just levied a fine against owed us $6,400. He mentioned that we needed to contact his payee as it related to payment because his payee wasn't returning his calls. So upon getting back to the court, I have a lady who's in contact with this payee on a fairly regular basis. I asked her to call him, make sure he knew of the new fines. She called simply to inform him of the new fines and tell him that we needed $25 a month. And the payee said, well, how much does he owe total? And we told him the $6,400, and he said, well, I have $7,000 of his money. I'll write you a check. The story gets better. Of the $6,400 that he owed is $1,161 he incurred in 1987. Let me repeat that, 1987. $1,200 was incurred in January of 1988. We're getting all that money. We don't give up, and fines don't go away. I have people that appear before me and say, well, that was years ago. I said, yeah, I know, but what made you think it would go away? You still owe it. It gets better.
I know we've got this 5-minute limit from Doug. I've got a couple more questions for you.
This is good.
Okay. Don't cut out my questions. It'll
just take 30 seconds.
Okay.
So this payee indicated that he wanted to get that money paid to us because he has to carry a higher bond for whatever money he's holding. So he asked if we had any others. And I said, well, I don't know, because I only know if they're your client, if they bring it up to us. And he said, well, let me send you a list of my clients. He sent me a list of over 200 people that he is the payee for. Denise compared it to gambling. It's kind of like rolling the dice and seeing what you get. And I've been going down the list, and I've uncovered about $20,000 so far from those people. Hopefully,
congratulations.
I don't know yet whether he's got money for all those, but I'm like a kid in a candy store.
That's awesome. That's
good information.
Just some quick clarifications on that. The revenue that comes in, though it is generated by your department, goes into the general fund. Is that correct?
We don't take it.
Okay. And is the state's program, the set-off program, available for some of the other collections that we do, or only for your court collections?
I can only speak to us. I know it works for us. I don't know what criteria the state has. I think they take any municipality.
Anything?
We have certain, okay. I know there are certain exceptions for the courts that others don't enjoy. For instance, the collection fee with our collection company, the defendants are responsible for that. It doesn't come out of the court's money. That doesn't work the same way like for a water bill. The statute's written particularly for the courts collecting fines.
Mr. Gerber?
I was just going to say, at the conclusion of your questions, perhaps Nikki Lee can address collection generally across
okay.
the city. I think she sent that out as a supplement to the council, but she can go over that very briefly with you.
Yeah, and if she could then touch on whether that program is available. It sounds like the courts are the only place we're using it. So just quick clarifications while you're still up front.
I want to clarify your last, because I thought you asked me about fines. Fines go to the general fund. Some of our fees go other places, particularly to the state. Court cost. If you look at the court cost, it's broken down to about 15 different categories, many of which do not go to the city. They go to the state.
Okay. Thank you.
Fines all go to us.
The number that you stated at first in terms of fines and fees that you're collecting, it's probably the same one from our report, but
probably not, because I gave you a gross figure.
Okay. What is that number, please, again?
The $4 million figure. I actually have a handout.
You mentioned that you had 30,244 cases, and then right after that mentioned a number in terms of fines.
I have gross receipts for the last 5 years, and I made enough copies that I can share those with you.
Okay.
And last year it was $4,209,000.
Okay. Thank you. And could you mention again, you mentioned how many staff you had. I thought you said four in probation, and I wasn't.
Four protective service officers, security, and four probation people in the probation department, 11 clerical staff, two administrators of the courts, the court administrator, the deputy, two judges. And by the way, I meant to mention,
I'm not sure that matches what's in the book.
It better.
I know it doesn't, but they may be a portion.
One of those probation people is not out of the general fund. That might explain the discrepancy.
Okay.
They're paid with ADSAP money.
Right.
But anyway, I did want to mention that Judge Schwartz is our second judge. He also serves as an administrative judge, but he does that in a capacity independent from municipal court.
So just to clarify with you all before we move on, what's on page 54 then is only the positions that are funded out of the, I mean, this mentions just two small grants, actually. It's only the general fund positions, and there are actually
more? Yeah, that should match what I gave you.
Well, you said four in probation, and the judicial obviously combined
some. The three there, and then the fourth one is under ADSAP. Those are the four from probation.
Gotcha. Okay. Thank you. All right.
Well, to kind of follow up with going after fines and fees, have we ever had a program where we, I guess, boot the car? If they have a car, they can't move it?
That's parking. They do
that's
have
That's parking?
That.
Okay.
But we do have that.
We introduced it
about 4 years, 4 years ago, maybe?
We do have that program, yes.
Mm-hmm.
And I think when Doug Whitaker gets up
successful.
Here, he'll be prepared to talk more about parking
okay.
issues.
Okay.
Okay. Good.
Okay. Thanks.
All right. Let's move on. And then we'll talk more about fines at the end. Thank you very
Thank
much.
You,
I'll be here for a while. I do have a doctor's appointment that before you're done, I may have to leave.
Okay. Thanks for coming as long as you could.
Sure. In supplement two, and then also the supplement we just sent out, supplement four. Supplement two, we gave an overview of who all does collections. So in that, we listed out that actually code enforcement, municipal codes, police department, parking, WPC, water, planning, and traffic all use some kind of, have some kind of collections. Most use the Collection Bureau of Kansas. What I'm not sure about, and I'll have to follow up with, is can all those groups use state set off? I couldn't answer that off the top of my head, but I'd be happy to ask that question for you if that's what you're asking. And then the prior supplement gave dollar amounts of those groups that use those, and then what the rates are that the agencies keep, what the actual dollars were that we got in 2014, and in some cases so far in 2015.
Hey, Nikki, have we questioned with the League of Municipalities, you know, what other cities are doing and what seems to be really effective. I mean, even to the point of what credit, you know, what business they're using to go after fines and fees. Because I know that, you know, if you added up all the fines and fees that are owed to the city, I'm sure it would be a significant amount.
I don't believe we've ever had that direct conversation with the league. It's just my experience in different cities tells me there's different ways to do it, but it all involves having a company help you go after those fines, as well as using the state set off to supplement those fines collections.
Okay, thank you.
So your thought about spending more time on that at the end was right now. So this is it. Okay, and I did submit a response when we got number four today asking for more. I was pretty sure that the council wanted more on the code compliance one, because that gross number that they had, we bill out for demolitions. We also bill out for weeds and nuisances and a variety of other things. And so I asked if it was available for them to give us more on that. All right. Looks like we're ready for the next one.
For the legal department.
Legal, all right. So page 50?
50, correct.
Okay.
The legal department has 9 attorneys and 6 support staff. And you have a city attorney who runs the office, essentially.
I'll stop just for a second. For those watching, this is Mary Feeney, who's the acting city attorney.
Yes. Get on my TV.
Continue.
The government law division has 2 attorneys who provide legal advice to 22 city departments. The litigation division has 2 attorneys who defend the city in litigation and handle administrative matters that are litigation in nature, such as mediations and arbitration. Litigation has 1 support staff. The government law division, which I just mentioned, has 2 support staff. And then finally, our prosecution division, we have the chief prosecutor and then 3 attorneys who prosecute traffic violations and criminal misdemeanors. You just heard from the court. In 2014, there were over 21,000 court cases. The prosecution division has 3 support staff. Our budget, in 2013, the legal department had 17 and a half FTEs. We dropped down to 14 in 2015. And for 2016, we are going to 15 FTEs. And the extra FTE is a legal specialist for the prosecution division. And if you have specific questions, I can entertain them now.
The legal specialist is one of the 3 support people that you mentioned when you gave us the overview?
That is correct, yes.
And that's, you haven't had 3 before?
Well, not since probably 2013.
Okay, but we did have that many before?
I believe so, yes.
Okay.
There's a lot of paperwork and a lot of clerical work that needs to be done in the prosecution division, a lot of paper, and so that's the reason. For 3.
Even with electronic filing,
even
still a lot of paper.
Yes, paper, yes, and computer input, and so anyway, that's the reason.
Okay.
Questions? Okay, thank you.
You're good. Thank you.
We'll have Brendan Wiley come up now and give you an overview of the world famous Topeka Zoo.
Yeah. Oops. Oh well, just disappeared.
This?
No. Okay.
Deputy Mayor, Councilwoman Schwartz, thank you for this opportunity. I just gave you a handout that essentially is the same information in the budget book, but presented a little bit differently. Now, sometimes I know that people think like budget processes like this just really stink, are terrible things to do. And then you realize that's not what stinks. But actually, she doesn't stink either. So we wanted to introduce you to one of our friends from the zoo. Her name is Luna, Luna is going to wind up being rescued here in just a minute.
There's Luna. Oh.
And as she is rescued, I'll go ahead. And
municipal court's trying to figure out who they can bring next time. I can see this conversation going on in the back. Okay, continue.
Thank you. And Dennis Dinwiddie is our education and conservation person at the zoo. And thanks for taking your time, Dennis, to bring Luna down here. So back to the handout. On the first page, very simply, who we are and what we do. Our mission is to enrich the community through wildlife conservation and education. I did put a graph in the center page relating to the zoo's attendance. Attendance is frequently one of the metrics used to evaluate is a zoo on the right track. And I think it's also important to consider from an attendance perspective, is it being used enough to justify its cost? And we are in a trend where our attendance is increasing. A couple notable facts about some of our attendance trends include, of the 301 school field trips in 2014, 145 of those came from outside of Shawnee County. We're seeing a much bigger trend in usage through school groups from outside the county, which is great. But it also points to the fact that we need to become more accessible to schools right here in Shawnee County. So that's an initiative that we will be working on. And then that bottom bullet point, once we really started studying who it is that comes to the zoo, an interesting fact was that 49% of the people that come are over the age of 12. Now, most sources consider that for places like zoos, your target audience is between 7 and 11 years old. Now that we know this about our demographic, you will see some new things added to our communication over the next several years. Our operating budget since 2014 has been, for the most part, flat, with small increases attributed to basically the cost of personnel and some of the contractual obligations. And you can see that on page 2, both reflected in the overall budget, and the graph at the bottom of the page speaks specifically to personnel. We have 22 full-time employees. That number's been constant since 2014, and same number proposed in the 2016 budget. Our turnover rate with employees is between 5 and 8%, which translates to 1 to 2 people a year, which is actually less than industry, lower than the industry average. The next page is the real meat of the zoo operating budget. The graph at the top points to our contractual portion of our budget. And our budget in a nutshell, 52% gets spent on employees. Another 38% gets spent on contractual services. Of those contractual services, it's utilities and facility maintenance that uses the bulk of that money. 67% of our contractual services is spent on utilities and facility maintenance. And as a conservation organization, utilities is one of those areas that we really want to focus on, reducing the use of utilities as much as possible. As our budget relates to commodities and capital, less than 1% of our operating budget gets spent on capital, although it is worth noting that the zoo has two projects in the 2016 CIB. Commodities makes up the remaining 10% of our budget, and the graph at the bottom of page 3 shows quite clearly that the bulk of that is food for the animals that live at the zoo. Next to that is pharmaceuticals and lab supplies, and then consumables, which are those items that we go through caring for the animals over the course of a year. Much like the judge said, this is a relatively status quo budget. If there were some of the newer members of the council here, I would have segued to the following point, and that is, unlike some of the other departments, we do have a support society that does amazing things for our zoo, creates new opportunities, and actually runs a significant portion of our operation in terms of the guest experience and fundraising purposes. So even with the status quo budget, we have still been able to grow, provide new opportunities, and even lengthen the stay of our typical guest.
Thank you very much, and thanks for making your reference to the new council members. Remember that the public is watching, so it's good to share those. People are very interested in how your departments are running, all of you, and we also have, I know Councilwoman Ortiz was very interested in this, simply could not get away at this time, and so I imagine she'll be watching, and other new council members as well. So hopefully, in fact, maybe we can send out these handouts to those so that if council members want to see them, they can. This is great. Could you actually talk a little bit more about your Friends of the Zoo, or let's say, yeah,
yes.
It's FOS now, not TFOTS or whatever, in terms of how many staff they have, because you're in a capital campaign as well. And
correct.
So talk about what they are contributing to the operation that we don't see here. Just one more.
Originally, Friends of the Zoo was established actually by Gary Clark in his second year as being the zoo's first zoo director. And it was started to be a nonprofit fundraising support organization. And over the past about 42 years, we have seen a number of projects develop at the zoo as a result of having that support. About 20 years ago, Friends of the Zoo also started running the zoo's gift store. About 10 years ago, when a new office building was built at the zoo, Friends of the Zoo and the city portion of the zoo both shared office space. And what we have seen is just literally kind of that partnership blossom to the point where in 2013, we more formalized that public-private partnership to the point where Friends of the Zoo operates the gift store as they had. They operate our concession stand, our admission function, as well as the custodial care of the public grounds, which is a chunk of that operation that gets more expensive as you get more people coming to you. So by that organization taking over that piece, they could reinvest the revenue that comes in through it, meaning that if you're gonna sell 1,000 more hot dogs, they have access to the revenue they make from selling hot dogs to buy more hot dogs. In addition to that, they provide marketing support, website support, fundraising support, and event support. Currently, they have 6 full-time employees and 26 actually part-time employees, which is another extremely beneficial advantage to the city budget, that we don't have to employ that seasonal workforce. They can do it, and they can strategize and position it better because it can ebb and flow with the revenue that's coming in to offset it. And as you mentioned, yes, they are running a capital campaign for what will hopefully be the first major piece of new infrastructure to open in 2017.
Just in case you didn't know it,
we are still getting periodic letters from all over the world about saving our
about elephants. Yes.
So I answer one every once in a while just to make sure I'm current on what we're doing.
And I did notice recently that it was updated to include our current city manager as opposed to Dan Stanley at this point. But it might be good. I will find some way to kind of recap that history in a nutshell for
Wouldn't
members
be a bad
of the
idea.
Council that did not get to experience that.
Two rounds.
Yes.
Questions?
Yeah, thank you. Do you know why there was a dip in 2013 for attendance? I mean, it went down in 2013.
We are very much tied to the weather. Okay. And 2013, well, if I take a step back, in 2012, we brought in a traveling penguin exhibit. And we may have had the busiest May in history. 2013, we brought in a traveling alligator exhibit, and we had one of the coldest wet springs we'd ever had. It snowed the very first Saturday in May. We brought in alligators that suddenly were having to wrap the enclosure with plastic and heat, and when you get snow on a Saturday in May, and you've got my job, you're almost in tears. So it's really reflective of a cold, wet spring that we simply could not recover from. This year has been very interesting. With a wet May, we still had 32,000 people. We're a little behind of where we were last year, but I think our approach this year with a new lorikeet feeding aviary and a new play area, our approach will have more stay power than some of the years prior. The question is just how hot is July going to be?
Okay.
And if I may, Brendan, do we have, I know we've had, I've heard of one wedding that was at the zoo.
Yes.
Do we have any other special events, birthday parties, or anything that attracts, you know, a large group at once?
We do birthday parties three times a day, almost every weekend day.
Really?
Throughout the summer, we even do them in the winter. They're just not in as high of demand. That is another function of Friends of the Zoo because of the costs that go up and down with the popularity. We hold a number of different events from ZooBelieve, which is the annual fundraiser. Brew at the Zoo is a week from Saturday. We do what we call corporate safaris, Advisors XL, Target Distribution are two of the recent ones that essentially had their company picnic at the zoo. And weddings are not as common at the zoo as they once were, but we would love to bring that back. It's where I'd want to get married.
And my final question has to do with grants. If we
yes.
had a full-time grant writer that searched for grants, are there grants out there for zoos?
There are grants for zoos. And not just specifically for zoos, but you know, speaking to the wanting to make our zoo more accessible to schools right here in Shawnee County, there's a number of different education support grants, grants that support the environment.
So are those usually philanthropical grants, or are they government-connected grants?
All the above.
All the above.
Through U.S. Fish and Wildlife has one that we're looking at. Honda is another. We recently got one from Westar.
Okay. For you, between you personally and your staff at the zoo and then the Friends of the Zoo, do you pretty much have the capacity to do the grant writing that you need? I don't mean that to be a loaded question. So.
You know, it's kind of one of those things where if there's one more grant out there that you didn't apply for, then you wish you would have.
But at a certain point, having been a grant writer, you've got to know the stuff, even if somebody else was trying to write it, but you ended up having to give them all the information, you're going to spend as much time as you would have almost.
There is a chunk of time
to write it. I mean, unless you've got somebody that really is full-time and that is invested in what you do, not just sort of a journeyman grant person.
Yes.
I mean, you've got more grant writing assistants than some of our departments do.
And that is true. We are fortunate that way.
So, and not meant to
No, I don't have a problem with that. I know that grant writing is a specialty. It's a professional profession now.
Mm-hmm.
And I know we've had it department by department, but I really think that we need somebody dedicated to searching for grants for the city and writing them.
Thank you. More questions? Otherwise, I saw Doug scratching his nose a little earlier, and maybe it just itched, or maybe our 5 minutes was up. So either way, I think we probably need to move on.
Just an itch.
Okay.
Although we're at 17, so.
Thanks,
Thank
Brendan.
You, Brendan.
Thanks.
This will probably be our last one before break. Thank you. And police department is, I assume we're going to page 62.
Yes, ma'am. So James Brown, your chief of police, sitting next to me. On my left, your right is Gretchen. She's our budget manager for the police department. We're going to talk about the police department budget for 2016.
Okay.
The requested budget for 2016, $37,647,372. 84% of that cost is for personnel. 16% is for non-personnel. For non-personnel uses, 5.5% is reallocated back into other units within the city. For example, IT, we take $1 million out of our budget and give to IT so that they can function, the IT unit. And teletime, insurance, facilities, fleet pays is 5.5% of the department's budget. That leaves 4.2%, $1,568,651 for flexible spending. Flexible spending, training, we spend $90,000. $193,000 for our uniforms and equipment. Software maintenance alone is $258,999. DNA specialist, $78,000. Second page. Police department is broken down into four bureaus. The chief's office, 29 FTEs with a budget of $5,056,000. Field operations, 180 FTEs with a budget of $16,982,000. And below each bureau, we have it, the names of the units in which falls underneath the bureau. Support operations, which are your motorcycles, bikes, response team, bomb unit, narcotics, organized crime, gang unit, school resource officers, 89.5 FTEs, $9,481,780. Criminal Investigation Bureau, 55 FTEs with a budget $6,126,292. Page 3. So the number of calls for service in 2014, 119,692, 7,229 traffic stops, 8,432 citations, 432 accidents worked, 348 DUI arrest. Animal control handled 6,193 calls for service. We handled 581 auto thefts, recovered 412 of those vehicles. Criminal intelligence unit with the use of social media resulted in a 74% clearance rate from 109 cases posted, 79 suspects identified. Our 35 volunteers donated 155 volunteer hours to the police department, saving the agency $264,000. community policing officers attended 137 community meetings. Last page. We talk about current savings with salary due to starting the academy class in July versus January. That money will be going back to the city at the end of the year. Fleet reduction, we've been able to reduce the vehicle fleet from 166 vehicles to 122 vehicles. That's a reduction of 44 vehicles, saving an average of $33,000 per vehicle. Additional savings for the fuel maintenance parts repair, $237,000. Since November, we've been able to reclassify five command positions, going from 29 commanders to 24 commanders. Reclassifying three sergeants' positions, going from 38 sergeants to 35 sergeants, converting those other positions into patrol officer positions. And to date, we've been able to reclassify five corporals, two police officers' positions. We had 22 corporals. We'll be going down to 12 corporals here within the next couple of years with attrition. And talking about grants, Council Member Swartz, we've been able to move 124,000 of designated grants from the PD budget to social services. This allows for the agency to apply for grants for a more thorough, transparent process. We currently have six grants that we're working with the police department, trying to save taxpayers money with the capital city and using that grant money that's available through federal government. So we are a big user of grants in law enforcement, and we do have internal people that help us write those grants that have been doing it for quite some time. So we're pretty proficient at it. We've been doing it for quite some time, and it's something that that we believe in, and we're able to save our taxpayers hundreds of thousands of dollars, if not millions of dollars, over the years by utilizing these grants that are out there. But you're absolutely right, it does take time, and it takes somebody that knows how to go out there and identify these grants and that they're available, because you don't want to, you know, do like the zoo director said, you know, have something happening and then you kind of miss out on it because you heard from another zoo director that they got the grant and you didn't because you just didn't know about it. So this is kind of an overview of where the police department currently is, and I'll save the rest of my time for any questions if there is any.
That I must compliment you is a phenomenal consolidation of a huge department and lots of moving parts into a great presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Questions?
Thank you. This is a great presentation, and you everything that you hit on is the idea that we are moving progressively forward with some of our issues that were found out in the resource allocation study a couple years ago that I have been, you know, wanting to make sure that we are looking at, and I think that's what you're doing, is showing a lot of the decrease in some of the areas that need to be decreased. The fleet reduction of 44 vehicles, is that, did we have too many vehicles, or were they vehicles that were on their last leg, or how did we reduce the fleet 44 vehicles?
It was a combination of everything you just mentioned, and a lot of it was just having to get out of the office, go out to the parking lots and see what vehicles we had and which one hadn't been driven for a couple months, and then coming back and talking about it and saying, do we really need this vehicle in our fleet if we haven't driven it for a couple months? We've been able to do this, and nobody on the police department has recognized that we've reduced the amount of vehicles. So everybody that needs to be in vehicles are in vehicles. Those that were kind of sitting out in standby status and just sitting there in case we needed them, I thought it was the responsible thing to do to reduce that size, reduce the size of the footprint of our vehicle fleet, and we'll save hundreds of thousands of dollars over the years. You know, over the last few years, we've spent about $900,000 per year buying vehicles to replenish our current fleet. I think myself and Mr. Gerber, we have it worked out to where in future years, here in the next couple years, we'll be able to sustain our current fleet at $250,000 a year, therefore giving Doug more money in his coffers so he can do things like streets and sidewalks and the things that the city really needs.
Yeah. Okay.
We're trying to do our part, and we do hold a substantial amount of the city budget, so we just want to be responsible and make sure we're doing things the most efficient way possible.
Okay. If I may follow up, the resource allocation study, you know, I found that the average number of sworn officers per 1,000 residents was 1.82 compared to Topeka at 2.37. The lowest value in the range was Olathe at 1.35. The highest was Kansas City at 2.65. So with the reduction of the officers that you indicated, this number is actually coming down, the 2.37. So, and do you have any predictions as to a target number that you're looking at?
So this year we were authorized a funded strength at 300. Unfortunately, I'm probably not going to be able to reach that goal. We have had five testing cycles that we've been trying to recruit 40 officers. I think this next class that you guys had authorized to start January 6th, I'm only going to be able to put 27 qualified applicants into the class. Mm-hmm. So we're having a really hard time finding qualified applicants and meeting those recruitment goals. But I think this is something that the entire industry is experiencing right now. So next year we'll be able to sit back, analyze and evaluate and formalize more of a complete plan with what our force manpower is going to look like for the years to come based upon calls for service. How many crimes do we have, a reduction in crimes, or are we short in a certain area? I do believe we were short in the Bureau of Operations, so I have pulled from other specialty units and place those officers in the Bureau of Operations because I believe that our response times, we need to improve in that area. It's an officer safety issue, not having enough officers handling calls for service. And so I'd like to monitor it this summer to see where the calls, how many calls come in, and if we can handle it with the amount of officers that we have in the Bureau of Operations handling these calls for service. So probably by fourth quarter, I'll be able to get with city manager and staff to give my recommendation on what our funded end strength should be for next year.
And if I may, I had heard a report that when there's shift change, the calls may come in and they may not get answered as quickly. Is there a way that is that being handled differently now? Or, I used to run nursing homes, and if we had emergencies, people had to stay on the job and take care of the emergency. So, how do we handle shift change? Because that was brought to my attention that there was, I think dispatch said there were 6 calls in and people were waiting for a police officer to show up, and it was shift change.
Yeah, so some agencies, when they do shift change, when the new officers come in, the entire police department shuts down and the new shift gets ready to go out into the field. We don't operate in that style. We always have people out to the field to handle those emergency calls. So if it's an emergency call, we have people ready to respond 24/7, 365. There's always an officer out in the field ready to respond. Now, non-emergency calls, we put them in queue and we hold on to them for a little bit and wait for our officers to come out to the field. But any type of emergency calls, crimes in progress, crimes against people, we're able to respond to them because we do keep officers in the field at all times. We never deplete the entire force and bring them in and then set new ones out. So we stagger our roll calls to make sure that there are people in the field at all times. Okay. So sometimes there could be, we could back up some calls, especially on the afternoon shifts, on a weekend, on a Friday or Saturday night. Sometimes they do stack up on us, but we consider them non-emergency calls. But like burglaries in progress or crimes against people in progress, we always try to make sure people are available for immediate response.
And what is the shifts? I mean, what are hours? Do our shifts run 7 to 7 or 7 to 3 or?
So we have 3 shifts. We have days, afternoons, and midnights.
Okay.
And so the first roll calls would be at 5:30 and 6:30.
Okay.
And so that's where the stagger is. Half of the day shift comes in at 5:30, half comes in at 6:30.
Okay.
So when they get relieved 8 hours later, that first shift will get off duty an hour before the second shift, and then we have our midnight roll call.
Okay. Thank you. That's it.
Thank you. I had a constituent write in, and that person was concerned that we might be spending a lot of tax money on vehicles or otherwise for various honor guard activities. Could you, like, he thought we'd bought a new van and a trailer and some things like that. I don't know if that's so. Could you respond in terms of the honor guard activities?
So for our vehicles, we were authorized to spend $900,000 this year on vehicles. Honor Guard activities, I believe we spent last year, and it was last year's money, $25,000 on the Honor Guard to equip a new bagpiper and band corps for the city of Topeka.
Okay, so, and I didn't mean to put you on the spot
nope.
on that or anything, I just had heard, and so
yeah, no,
not a vehicle, vans, or trailers that are specifically for that use, any answer being okay?
We've talked about purchasing vans for the training academy. For example, right now we have a class getting ready to start of 27 recruits. We don't have transportation. If we wanted to take the 27 recruits to like Shunga Trail to run PT, we don't have a way to get all the recruits from point A to point B. I think in the past we've told them to get in their personal vehicles and drive to the point to do PT. I think that's problematic when we order one of our employees to get into their personal vehicle and drive it somewhere else. If we could just put them into a city vehicle and transport them, and we could get dual usages out of this van if we elect to purchase it. We haven't purchased it yet, but it could be used to transport the Honor Guard. So we have 17 members of our Honor Guard unit. So if we were gonna go do honors in a different city for a fallen officer, right now we have to take numerous police cars to do that. If we could have one van to help transport everybody, but it would be a multi-purpose use vehicle, which would include transporting recruits, which would include transporting Honor Guard members, which would include transporting any city employee. If Doug Gerber needs a van on a weekend to transport 10 of his employees to Kansas City to a meeting, this would be an asset that would be available for any type of city use.
Okay. We actually have some vans, I think. I remember buying a couple of new 15-passenger vans not long ago, so that would be something to look into, possibly, if we already have some. So, good. Thank you.
You're
just
welcome.
Wanted to go ahead and pass that question along.
Absolutely.
This moment. Other questions, Councilwoman?
Thank you for your time. Thank you.
We're done with this. Let's go ahead and break. Do we need more than 5 minutes or so?
No, and I'm sure everybody would just like to move forward.
I think so. I think we're moving
make
along
sure
pretty
it's five
well.
Minutes.
I don't have a check off, but I think we're doing well. Thank you so much, everyone. We'll meet back here at iShow 327, so 3:30, 3:35. We'll roll.